The Oakmont, we were on the way to a Buck Institute meeting, actually, and told me about it, and I said, you know, we've got to have a talk on that. And now, we finally have it, and it's very exciting, and so I want you to welcome our good friend Jennifer.
Thanks very much. It's great to join the three-timers club. Just a couple of housekeeping notes first. If you can't hear me, sort of wave and point at your ears. And if you're seated in a place where the podium blocks your view, that's constrained by our wires, feel free to move to another seat. And if anybody needs the bathroom, I found out it's about 200 yards that way in AB building complex. And we're all the way up here in AB.
There's one down here too, John, not too far.
Oh, I didn't find it. Okay.
Right here to the left and send you right there.
Okay, so you got two choices, that way or that way.
Closer.
Okay. I'm going to be talking about the American Aging Association meeting that was held in Baltimore in June. Just briefly hitting the highlights because all of the abstracts are already on their website, and much of it was a reiteration of Jim Joseph's book, The Color Code, which you can buy and read, so I don't have to waste too much time telling you what it already says. Then I'm going to be talking a little bit about the origins, of, or what's known of the origins of Alzheimer's disease, and about I'd call it a new drug, but actually it's an old drug with a new application, a potentially effective treatment for both Alzheimer's and Parkinson's diseases, and possibly other neurodegenerative diseases and cataracts, all of which involve a similar transition metal cause. This some of you have seen before. It's not very legible there. In fact, even at this size, it's not very legible. So I'm starting to print out larger sizes. But in going to all of these meetings and talking with so many scientists, many of whom are specialists in certain aspects of aging, it was hard for me to keep everything straight in my brain without writing up a map. So I started to try and write down, first on paper and then on the computer, how different mechanisms involved in oxidative stress in mitochondria, lysosomes, in free radicals in the cytosol, and changes in the nucleus, the telomeres, and the chromatin all interact with extracellular cross-linking to lead to various pathologies at the cellular level and at the whole body level that result in aging and death. Can people hear me in the back okay? Good. Anyway, maybe afterwards, during question and answer or during a break or something, if people want to get copies of this, I'll tell them how they can get it. It's also on my website, but it's very hard to print off of the website. So just wanted to alert you that it keeps getting updated every few months. Okay, the American Aging Association is hosted by a different president each year, which is elected by the membership. And this year it was hosted by Jim Joseph, who wrote The Color Code. He's a researcher at Tufts University, and they have the contract from the Department of Agriculture to study various fruits and vegetables to determine their antioxidant potential and their health benefits. So much of what was discussed at this meeting, entitled Nutritional Modulation of Aging and Age-Related Diseases, actually was background material that went into this book. And because it's in this book, and all of the abstracts are on the American Aging Association website for free download, I'm not going to spend a lot of time going over all of that. The summary is, eat a rainbow every day. The more highly colored the fruits and vegetables are, the more their antioxidant potential, because the same chemical property which gives them an antioxidant potential, the ability to stabilize an extra electron, is found in the polyphenolic rings. Rings of carbon that are attached to each other distribute the charge. That same chemical structure causes them to absorb certain wavelengths of light and to have bright colors. So the obvious question, of course, is what vegetable came out lowest and most worthless? It was cucumber. In addition to the brightly colored fruits and vegetables, nuts, tea, and cocoa all have beneficial antioxidant effects and anti-inflammatory effects, which vindicates eating chocolate, except, of course, to turn cocoa into chocolate, you add a lot of fat and sugar, which is not so good for you. But if you eat the really bitter stuff, it's better for you than if you eat the really sweet milk chocolate.
What kind of tea is that?
Green tea and black tea. They both come from the same plant, but the black tea is, the green tea is simply the dried small leaves, and the black tea, they put it in a sealed can and let, they call it fermenting. It's not exactly fermenting, but it's a process that results in black tea in a few months. Interestingly enough, the best discussion of green tea and black tea and vitamins and antioxidants in general I've found is on the Linus Pauling Foundation website. And they present a nice pie chart of the different antioxidants you find in green tea and black tea, and they form a perfect complement. There's stuff that's high in green is low in black, the stuff that's high in black is low in green, and they're both beneficial. So I've started eating and drinking a couple of cups of each every morning. Yeah?
What we do is we take a teaspoonful of green tea and stick it into a salad, eat it, and my hope is that if it sits in my gut for 8 hours, it'll deliver a lot more whatever than any amount of you can get out of tea. Is there, that's a guess. Do you have anything to add to that?
I haven't seen any research comparison between an infusion made by boiling hot water over the dried leaves and what would come out in your stomach acid and intestines. So I don't know, but if you want to cover all your bases, do that and drink the cup. There were some interesting talks on oxidative stress and inflammation and its relation with Alzheimer's, diabetes, cardiovascular diseases. There was an interesting session on fats, the good, the bad, and the ugly. In terms of fats, I've been a vegetarian for years and only recently occasionally started eating salmon. But for more than 20 years, I didn't eat any kind of meat or fish at all. And I've been getting my omega-3 fatty acids from flax oil. And there's been some discussion in this forum here in past years about whether your body can convert the shorter flax oil omega-3s into the longer omega-3s that are essential to our body. And somebody in the American Aging Association meeting actually had an answer to that question. The answer is yes. His name is Lloyd Harrops from Ohio State University, and he knows quite a lot about these omega-3 fatty acids and says that we all have enzymes which convert the flax oil into the longer acid omega-3 fatty acids that you would find in fish and cold water fish oils. He also suggested, although they haven't measured this, that people who are strict vegetarians and their only source of omega-3 is flax oil might actually upregulate those genes in response to the need for more of the longer chain omega-3 fatty acids, which I thought was an interesting possibility.
Question?
Yeah.
In the research that I did, I found about 20% is converted. So yes, it's converted.
But at low efficiency.
But the 80%, most of it was beta oxidized to energy.
Well, okay.
So it doesn't, so eat four times as much. With that. The question was, is you're talking about any substantial amount?
Yeah, I eat a couple tablespoons a day.
No, I mean, of this conversion.
Yeah.
Is he talking about a substantial amount of conversion?
No, he was also talking about a rather low conversion ratio, but it might be what you need, depending on how much you eat. If you eat enough, you'll get enough.
How do you spell his name?
Harrocks. H-O-R-R-O-C-K-S. And you can find his abstract on the website at the American Aging Association. He's at Ohio State University, Columbus.
John, I've heard that hemp oil also has a good complement of omega-3 fatty acids and other things.
That's I've heard right. that, too. I haven't actually studied it in detail.
A little bit better than fox oil.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, well,
I tend to go for bang for the buck. I mean, evening primrose oil is very good, and borage oil is very good, but in terms of bang for the buck, I've been finding flax oil at Trader Joe's is the best value.
I've been looking for 20 years. Yeah. You know, flax oil, and then I use I'm going to have to open my mouth. I can't think of it now. That's the purple flax flour on it. Jarrow, J-A-R-R-O-W brand. One of the best. No light, no, they extract under nitrogen, etc.
That's an important consideration. The flax oil is very sensitive to oxidation. And you want to keep it in a light-proof container. You want to keep it in your refrigerator. And you want to keep it tightly sealed when not in use. And what I always do is an idea I got from Dirk and Sandy's book 20 years ago, which is... I take a half a teaspoon of BHT and dump it in a pint of my oil when I first open it, and that acts as an antioxidant.
The good thing about this these sources of organics is that they have a tremendous amount of vitamin E in those, the mixed teas, which is good.
So what do you think of the work of David Horaban, who talks about some people lack this enzyme delta-6 desaturase and can't convert, I guess, it's the alpha-linolenic acid, the gamma-homolinolenic acid. And so those are the ones like eczema patients or Sjogren's disease patients that he says that primrose oil and borage oil would be better for.
Well, that's why we have good doctors like you to treat the unusual cases. I'm looking at the general population, and I'm not a doctor. Everybody should realize that anything I say is just a result of my observing the work of others or doing limited research on my own, and I'm not a licensed doctor, but we have a couple in the audience, and they're licensed to tell you what to do and to diagnose special cases, which I cannot do. Thanks. And let's see if we've got anything else. Okay, he suggested that you need about 500 milligrams a day of the elongated DHA. And if the conversion ratios are correct, that would require eating 15 grams a day of flax oil in order to convert it into 500 milligrams a day of DHA. So he was using about a 1 to 20 ratio. But he suggested that the ratio might be upregulated in people who had only flax as their source of omega-3s. Let me just switch to the next slide. Okay, also announced at this meeting for the first time was the Methuselah Mouse Prize. A group of philanthropists have put together a cash award to encourage academics and others throughout the world to start working on aging seriously in vertebrates and focus them to move their work from flies and worms and amoebas and E. coli into actual mammals, that is mice, which have short enough lifespans that you can get a life extension answer within a couple of years, and they're close enough, much closer to humans than flies and worms. The elegans, of course, is a worm. So I thought it was very clever of them, and they set it up to be an ongoing prize. So if somebody breaks the record this year, they get a certain fraction of the money depending on how much longer than the previous record they got. And if somebody breaks their record the next year, they get a certain fraction of the remaining money based on how much longer than the record they broke is. So it's a very clever way to never run out of money. And the more donations they get, the more that they can offer the researchers. And they've also got a very sophisticated coding system. Any scientist who wants to try out his particular or her particular method of extending the life of a mouse has to register the mouse with their agency. They put an ear tag in it. It's got sophisticated coding set up by this guy who works for Tom Ridge. And and so it's almost cheat-proof. I would say it's cheat-proof. But anyway, it's a very sophisticated way to know that they're not switching the mice, because you're going to have to wait a couple of years while they're treating them to see if they beat the previous record. You can read about it on the web at methuselahmouse.org. And so I'm very happy to see philanthropic work going to encourage life extension research. Brief notes. I guess that was to tell me to talk about that that research that I just talked about. Let's see if there was another one. There's a little bit of talk about various upcoming treatments for Alzheimer's disease, but nobody had anything that they could report or give away or show or anything. One was called the VK21 from Israel, but they said you can't get it yet, and so maybe next year. So I'm going to move on to the main topic of the evening and refer you to the color code and refer you to the American Aging Association website for more details about what took place at the meeting. There are a couple of meetings coming up later this year. The big one of the year is the International Association of Biomedical Gerontology. They've got an excellent list of speakers. It's in Cambridge, England, and the registration fee includes lodging in the Cambridge College and includes food. So those of you who want to go to England in the middle part of September, I encourage you to attend. I think it'll be the highlight of the year. The Society for Free Radical Biology and Medicine is having their annual meeting in Seattle right before Thanksgiving, and overlapping with it, the Gerontological Society of America is meeting in San Diego also the week before Thanksgiving. To understand a little bit about the origins of Alzheimer's disease, I'll review briefly oxidative stress, which many of you have studied in the past, and for some of you it's a new topic. Redox is a contraction of the words reduction and oxidation. They're two sides of the same coin. An electron gets handed from one molecule to another molecule, and one of the molecules is oxidized, the other one is reduced. The one that does the oxidizing is reduced, the one that does the reducing is oxidized. And if you really want to get into it, you might want to go to the community college and take a course in chemistry. But I'm going to be talking about what we can do with this. We hear the term free radical a lot. It's either a molecule or an atom. It's generally a molecule that has an unpaired electron, and that unpaired electron desperately wants to pair up. And it does it by either giving away its unpaired electron or grabbing another electron from somebody else. And so it either reduces or oxidizes another species. Many of these free radicals contain oxygen, so we call them reactive oxygen species. So you'll often hear these terms used somewhat interchangeably, even though there are fine differences of meaning. One of the things that happens is when they come in contact with a lipid that is forming the membrane of the cell or a membrane of an organelle inside the cell, they can oxidize that lipid and start a chain reaction, because the peroxidized molecule then peroxidizes the molecule next to it, the peroxidizes the molecule next to it, and pretty soon all of the lipid molecules in this membrane in a very small space are oxidized and the membrane becomes leaky. You get pinholes and the membrane is no longer able to do its function of supporting, of separating components of the cell into distinct compartments. When free radicals come in contact with proteins, they add things to them called adducts, or they'll stick one part of a protein to another part of the same protein or a different protein. That's called cross-linking. It changes the shape of the protein and as a result degrades its function, because proteins in our body generally are either structure, and shape is important for linking the Lego blocks together, or they're little molecular catalysts called enzymes, and shape is very important for their job of promoting chemical reactions. Finally, free radicals which come in contact with the DNA, nucleic acid, can cause a damage which can result in either change in gene expression or even heritable changes, which we call mutations. Now, another thing that oxidation and reduction do is they change the signaling status in the cell. The cell has an intricate signaling system in which molecules are constantly handing off phosphate groups from one to another, and sometimes hydrogen atoms from one to another. And the balance between oxidized and reduced versions of the same molecule is called the redox equilibrium or the redox poise. One of the primary examples is the balance between reduced glutathione and oxidized glutathione. And as many of you know, glutathione is one of the most important natural antioxidants in the cell. So we have oxidation affecting the structure and function of large molecules, proteins, lipids, and DNA, and we also have it affecting signaling. And if the redox poise gets pushed too far to the oxidized state, it can trigger the cell into an irreversible cascade of apoptosis or programmed cell death. And if it's a cell which isn't easily replaced, like a brain cell, a muscle cell, a heart cell, you end up with fewer of them. And we, of course, have hopes that our friends who are working on stem cell therapies will find ways eventually to replace these things. But to the extent that we can avoid killing them off, we're better off. Finally, the redox poise also alters the actions of some enzymes, because this equilibrium can subtly change the environment for enzymes, which will subtly change their action. And some proteins act as transcription factors, which either enhance or repress the expression of certain genes. So we've got chromatin, which is the folding structure of the DNA. We've got telomeres, which are very sensitive to redox. In fact, it has been suggested by Ken Beckman over in Bruce Ames' lab that telomeres actually act as a sponge for oxidative stress on the DNA. They're able to siphon some of the oxidative stress away from the functional genes onto the telomere, and in so doing, the telomere gets shorter, which is why you find that when you're looking at Hayflick limit studies, if they're done under high oxygen, you only get fewer divisions of the cell before the cell culture dies. If they're done under low oxygen, low oxidative stress, you get many more cell divisions before you run out of telomeres and the cell culture halts. So briefly, reactive oxygen chemistry. Mitochondria are the power plants in the cell. They have iron sulfur complexes in the electron transport chain, and these are somewhat leaky, and the iron sulfur complex occasionally drops a single electron onto an oxygen molecule before it's supposed to, and we get a species called superoxide. Now, because superoxide could be hazardous to the cells if it hangs around, The body has an enzyme called superoxide dismutase, which converts superoxide into hydrogen peroxide. However, hydrogen peroxide is more stable than superoxide. The more radical or the more reactive a free radical, the sooner it's going to hit something and react, and then it's not a radical anymore unless it causes a chain reaction. But hydrogen peroxide is more stable, and being uncharged, it can diffuse through membranes, get out of the mitochondria, go around the cell. And if it runs into an iron or a copper particularly, and sometimes a zinc, it can be converted by a reaction called Fenton reaction into a radical called hydroxyl, which is even more damaging to membranes than superoxide was in the first place, which is why our body has other protective mechanisms such as catalase and glutathione peroxidase to get rid of H2O2 before it goes through a Fenton reaction. So it becomes a wandering of the H2O2 through the cell, and it either runs into something that turns it into something bad, or it runs into something that deactivates it and turns it into water. So I already mentioned the pinholes. If this runs into a lipid membrane, it starts a lipid chain reaction, which can be quenched if there's enough vitamin E in the lipid, and vitamin E is very good at quenching reactions in lipids, and also alpha-lipoic acid. So, pathologies of oxidative stress, you get a loss of elasticity in the extracellular matrix, in arteries, lungs, kidney, etc., gets stiffer and less functional. You get neurodegenerative diseases, including Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, Huntington's, and a few others are also related to oxidative stress levels in the cells. Lou Gehrig's disease, ALS. Atherosclerosis is very sensitive to oxidative stress. You get a lot of peroxidized serum lipids participating in the formation of the atherosclerotic plaque. You get cell death, and when it's in cells which can't replace themselves, this is pretty serious. The cell death is signaled by the mitochondria and the general redox poise of the cytoplasm. And Doug Wallace had pointed out a couple of years ago that H2O2 seems to diffuse from the mitochondria to the nucleus, and under certain circumstances can act as a signal to tell the nucleus to start dividing. And if this signal is received inappropriately, it can cause cancer because it causes too much cell division.
John, can you talk about how fibrin is created?
Fibrin?
Fibrin from in this process.
I'm not an expert on fibrin. All I know is what's in the textbooks, and okay. I believe it's related to blood clotting.
Yeah,
and people with too much clots have problems, and people with too thin of blood have bleeding problems. So there's a balance that has to be maintained.
Well, it's associated with the inflammation that's caused by this.
Yeah, I'm not an expert in that area, okay. But thanks for the question. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about iron, because iron can be good or bad depending on whether it's in short supply or large supply. Without enough iron, the mitochondria get sick because they don't have enough iron to run their electron transport chain. Too much iron, and you can get a lot of the H2O2 in the cell being converted to hydroxyl radical before it can be neutralized or converted to water by catalase or glutathione peroxidase. So either iron deficiency or iron excess is harmful. We need a balance, and we probably need better home testing to find out whether we're in deficiency or excess. However, it turns out that cells cannot expel excess iron. It accumulates with age in non-dividing cells. So the older we are, the greater the chance that we don't have a deficiency. The older we are, the greater the chance that we have an excess and that we should be looking for ways to treat an excess rather than a deficiency.
Is it useful when it's, I mean, you're saying there's more, but it's just sort of stored there.
Well, some of it is stored in a usable form.
Oh, really?
In the cytoplasm. Some of it's stuck in these aggregates, such as amyloid beta that you find in Alzheimer's plaques,
right,
and aggregates inside of cells, such as in lipoplasm. So some of it's unusable, but a lot of it actually is usable.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that the cells can't get rid of it.
They found high levels of iron in people who have hepatitis.
John, does this mean that if someone is high in ferritin, like over 100, whatever the units are, I think that's, and has low blood cell, red blood cell count and low hematocrit and hemoglobin, that person should avoid foods with iron?
Well, I'm not a doctor, but that would be my reading of the data.
John?
Yeah.
There is a defense mechanism in the body that's related to the immune system in regards to how iron is bound and transported. And when the immune system turns on in response to an infection or an allergy, iron becomes more strongly sequestered so that the actual availability of iron in the blood decreases dramatically. And this is because iron is a powerful growth factor for most bacteria. It's found down in the mitochondrial compartment to very high degrees, and bacteria and mitochondria are very similar in many respects, and so I suspect that's where it comes from. But just to warn people that I think it's potentially very dangerous to give iron to somebody who has an active infection for that particular reason, and it may be that in terms of hepatitis, the high iron levels may be because iron is stored in the blood in a kind of compartmentalized form, that the liver is the organ that has to deal with that iron, and so that may be why you see elevated iron in the liver, in a chronic disease state like that.
That idea to chase the iron levels in cancer also by giving iron to cancer patients.
Yeah, any kind of chronic inflammatory condition, chronic oxidative stress, allergy. It doesn't matter whether it's an infection would be viral, fungal, bacterial, even something like leaky gut syndrome could produce a chronic inflammatory state that would cause this kind of disturbance in iron. And it's not also just restricted to iron. Copper and zinc also exhibit similar kinds of sequestration mechanisms.
What did he say about cancer?
Bad idea to supplement iron. If you get a low iron reading and you have cancer, you think, well, why should take iron? Bad idea.
Artemisinin is a herb or something that's supposed to go after the cancer cell that supposedly likes to grab onto iron. And sometimes they give them a little iron so that the cancer cell has the iron, and then the artemisinin is supposed to blow it apart or something.
Okay.
I have the opinion, and I can't justify it. Well, serum ferritin level.
You want to stand up so you can get.
Yeah, I guess the serum ferritin level between 20 and 40 is a good target. Is serum ferritin a good measure, and is the range 20 to 40 better than 100?
I'm not a clinician, I can't answer that.
Sorry. Anybody have a number on serum ferritin? I heard the number.
Because even though your cells can't get rid of iron once it's inside them, one of the regulatory mechanisms that they do have is that when the iron's in the blood bound to transferrin, they have transferrin receptors which they can upregulate or downregulate according to their perceived needs. So some cells might be taking more iron from the blood supply than other cells according to their perceived needs. But I can't answer your question on ideal levels.
One more comment. There was years ago studies on Alzheimer's and looking at the amount of iron as well as, of course, aluminum in people. And they looked at removing the iron by using desferoxamine,
yes,
which is given for iron. I don't know if it works for aluminum or not, but
I'll talk about desferoxamine on the next slide or a couple of slides down, because that's an important topic. Thanks for asking. Yeah.
Oh, no, I have a question for Steve. What you were saying, does that mean if you have an infection that you should stop taking copper and zinc?
It's acute, I would say yes. That you're likely to resolve the infection better than if you add it. And the same thing is true of tryptophan. Tryptophan is also an essential growth factor for microorganisms in the bloodstream, and there's an enzyme that's produced by immune system activation called indolamine dioxygenase, IDO, which wipes out tryptophan, 5-hydroxytryptophan, and other related, you know, structures. And if you add tryptophan during that kind of a time, you burden the system. And if the organism that you're fighting actually grows faster, you encumber your immune system.
Okay, so just basically, the iron in the blood is bound to a protein called transferrin, and when it's bound to that protein, it's not redox active. Iron enters the cell in response to transferrin receptors on the cell membrane, and through endocytosis, the way cells eat things, it forms a vacuole which merges with a lysosome, and it gets digested away from the receptor and the transferrin. And for a short time, it's in a fairly free redox active form in the lysosome before it's exported from the lysosome into the cytoplasm. And once in the cytoplasm, it's once again bound to a carrier protein, ferritin, and the ferritin keeps it from having redox activity. So it's fairly safe in the blood, and it's fairly safe in the cytoplasm, but during this transition period, while it's in the lysosome, it's not bound to a protective protein. It's not chelated, and it is redox active. So transition metals, iron and copper, deal in single electrons, i.e. they're able to create free radicals. Mitochondria have a lot of iron-sulfur complexes for their electron transport chain. The Fenton reaction, which takes place with iron or copper, converts hydrogen peroxide into hydroxyl radical, which is very reactive. Iron nucleates also, it causes aggregates of protein in substantia nigra cells called Lewy bodies, which are not very good for the cells because the iron in them tends to promote the creation of hydrogen peroxide and hydroxyl radical. Zinc and copper form amyloid beta plaques outside the cell in the neocortex of the Alzheimer's brain. Iron is a major source of free radical damage in lysosomes, mitochondria, and Lewy bodies. So these are some natural things which provide some protection against these transition metals in the brain. They're all able to get into the brain, and they're all somewhat protective. Desferoxamine has been studied for a number of years, both in the laboratory and to some extent clinically, but it's such a powerful chelator that it causes some problems with iron depletion. It also has to be administered by intramuscular injection. The injections are painful, and the desferoxamine disappears within a few minutes. It's very labile. So it's not a very suitable drug for all of those reasons. There's some other chelators such as EDTA, which are used for chelating lead in the bloodstream. They don't get into the brain though, and you really want something that gets into the brain if you're going to protect the brain. And EDTA, if it's used too chronically or too much, can also cause iron depletion diseases or metal depletion diseases. Julie Anderson at the Buck Institute up in Novato created a transgenic mouse that upregulates its ferritin expression and found that this mouse was protected from her artificially induced Parkinson's disease. Ashley Bush and Rudy Tanzi at Harvard Medical School in Boston we're studying the amyloid beta plaques, the deposits that form in Alzheimer's brain, and they discovered that in the test tube they only formed if there was some transition metal, or particularly copper, iron, or zinc in the medium in which they had this protein dissolve, that otherwise the A-beta would not spontaneously form these aggregated deposits. So they began to look at what it was that might chelate or sequester the iron, copper, and zinc and make these deposits less toxic. And they studied a number of different compounds and found out that this old antibiotic cleofenol worked the best. And fortuitously, it's not a very strong chelator, so it didn't have the potential for causing some of the depletion diseases that very strong chelators would. And it also fortuitously enters the brain, crossing the blood-brain barrier very readily. Julie Anderson's tried it after Ashley Bush suggested it to her, and she found that it also protected her mice from Parkinson's disease. And Ashley Bush and his colleagues started a company in Australia called Prana Biotechnology and started a clinical trial several years ago, which ran for 2 years.
John?
Yeah.
What does PD stand for?
Parkinson's disease.
Okay. Okay.
So Alzheimer's disease...
What happened to that clinical trial?
What?
What happened to that clinical trial?
Next slide. Alzheimer's disease is characterized by several things. It's characterized by a protein called tau, which aggregates into what are called tangles inside of neural cells, and it's characterized by deposits of protein called amyloid beta, which form plaques outside of cells in the same region of the brain called the neocortex. These amyloid beta plaques contain a lot of copper, zinc, and iron. They not only can convert H2O2 into hydroxyl radical, but they also chemically are able to convert water into H2O2. So they can do both things, which is really bad. And it kills cells in cell culture, and it kills cells in vivo, in brains. Methods of diagnosing Alzheimer's. Many of you have studied it in the past. Remember the statement that you really can't tell if somebody has had Alzheimer's until after they're dead and you do an autopsy. But just in the past couple of years, they've developed a PET scan, which can show amyloid beta plaques in living people. There are also psychological memory tests, which can give an indication of some kind of neurodegeneration, although they can't definitively define whether it's Alzheimer's or not. And there's a new EEG test that EEG operator research has discovered that can show evidence of early memory decline even before the psychological pencil and paper tests show it. So we've got some new tests out that should make it more effective. And this is important clinically for people to know whether they're at risk for developing Alzheimer's. If they had an early stage, they might want to take greater protective actions, although probably these protective actions are good for everyone anyway. They're important for research because it helps us to evaluate candidate treatments.
There's something quite new in the photonic spectra about using laser lights to visualize the retina
to determine, and they correlated with the Alzheimer's.
Fascinating. I want to look that one up. Maybe we can talk afterwards. Okay. So cleofenol is an old drug, but this is a new use for it. It has an In the older literature, it was called iodochlorhydroxyquine. It's related to quinine, so it's related to the old anti-malarial drug, but it's not exactly the same chemical. Currently, it's used in antibiotic skin ointments. It used to be used orally as an anti-amoeba drug for dysentery, traveler's diarrhea, and so forth. It was taken off the market after an incident of a disease called SMON, subacute myelo-optic neuropathy, was diagnosed in several thousand people in post-war Japan in the late 50s and early 60s. Now, and when SMON was first discovered, nobody knew what caused it. They were looking for a viral cause, and eventually they found a high correlation with people who had taken very high doses of clioquinol. And this caused enough concern of the manufacturer, Seiba Geigy, being afraid of lawsuits, decided that it wasn't worth it for the money they were making on travelers' diarrhea, that they took it off the market. I talked with the FDA last week. I talked with one of their general counsels, one of their lawyers, and asked them if he knew whether the FDA had taken it off the market or whether Seiba Geigy had taken it off the market. He looked through his database and said that happened in records that haven't yet been computerized because they're so old. It happened either in 1970 or in the 60s. He said if the FDA had taken it off the market, they were fully cognizant that Alzheimer's is a much more serious disease than traveler's diarrhea, and that if it could be proven that it was beneficial for Alzheimer's disease, they would be willing to put it back on the market because more serious diseases, you can put up with more serious side effects. Now, how can we get rid of the side effects altogether? Well, Bush and Tanzi at Harvard Med School took a close look at the SMON situation in Japan, and they figured out that it was sequestering and interfering with the metabolism of vitamin B12, and they concluded that the symptoms of SMON were due at least partly to B12 deficiency, probably combined with a very poor diet in post-war Japan and possibly some genetic factors, because 500 million doses were sold worldwide before it was taken off the market, yet only these 2,000 or 3,000 cases in Japan reported SMON, along with about 6 cases in Europe. So it was essentially a rare disease. The Harvard Medical School team believes that co-supplementation with vitamin B12 can make it a safe drug to take for Alzheimer's. And they started a clinical trial in Australia to test this hypothesis. So, clioquinol crosses the blood-brain barrier. It chelates copper, zinc, and iron in the amyloid beta and breaks the free radical Fenton reaction as a result. And interestingly enough, and totally unexpected to Bush and Tanzi, when it did this, the amyloid beta deposits started to dissolve because the metals were the nucleation for the crystallization of this protein glob. And also, they found in the mice and in the Australian clinical trial, not only did the amyloid beta dissolve, but the behavior improved. They could measure it behaviorally, they could measure it with PET scans, they could measure it by slicing open the brains of the mice. Only 9 weeks, the amyloid beta was reduced 50% in the mice, in 9 weeks. Now, mice don't normally get Alzheimer's disease. You have to create transgenic mice in order to get this mouse model, but still, it's the real A-beta in this mouse model. Now, one of the interesting talks in Baltimore was Carl Cotman from UC Irvine, and he works with dogs. Dogs actually do get Alzheimer's disease when they're old, and that makes it a very interesting model. His work was not with clioquinol, although I suggested to him that he might want to start studying that, or other people might want to study dogs and clioquinol because it's a more natural model of Alzheimer's disease. But he was studying things like fruits and vegetables and vitamin supplements, and found that things that were effective in the rats, such as blueberries and strawberries and spinach extracts and vitamin C and alpha-lipoic acid, all the really good things that you would you've been hearing about from me and from others over the past couple of years created noticeable differences in the behavior of the dogs. The dogs, he developed some very sophisticated dog intelligence and dog memory tests, and he could demonstrate with statistical significance that these things work. He also took another group of dogs and didn't give them these supplements, just gave them the normal diet, but enriched them. Now, by enrichment for a lab dog, this involved 2 walks a week.
Huh.
And having a cage mate. That was their idea of an enriched environment. And this also improved their cognitive abilities, reduced their rate of decline of cognition, and when he combined them, they were synergistic. He gave them a good diet and the enriched environment, it synergistically improved better than either one of those interventions alone. Anyway, back to this. So clioquinol, dose that they gave to the mice was 30 milligrams per kilogram body weight per day. And if you scale this up to a 150-pound human, that's about 2.1 grams per day. The clinical trial was done in Australia. It hasn't been published in a journal, but it was reported at the 2002 International Conference on Alzheimer's Disease and Related Disorders in Stockholm, Sweden. And Julie Anderson, in writing about her use of clioquinol in her mice, referred to this. So even though I don't have the printed publication of this paper, I have Julie Anderson's report of that meeting. And she said that he reported that with a double-blind, 2-year phase 2 clinical trial with dosing, quote, similar to the mouse study dosing, they found that it delayed Alzheimer's progression by 9 months.
Is that considered a big number? It doesn't look like a real big number to me.
And dogs?
No, this is in humans. This is the first this is the first results that we've seen. So,
John, how toxic is this? What kind of dose did they use?
They found no adverse side effects. The drug was well tolerated. They said they used a dose similar to the mouse study, which by my calculation is 2.1 grams per day.
So it delayed progression 9 months in 2 years. Is that correct?
Correct.
So that's a 40-something percent decrease.
Not bad.
That doesn't sound like a reversal.
Well, take this. This is fairly fresh data, and this is all we've got to go on. So,
not a reversal,
right? I'm not telling you to take it or to not take it. I'm just telling you this is the data.
But it's not a reversal.
It looks like it's slowing down the progression.
Mm-hmm. Why haven't they published the data?
If they have not told me why they have not published it, I have some speculations on why they haven't published it. I think it's on the next slide. It has to do with patent considerations. They, co-administered with vitamin B12. And I believe they also used selenium as well, just because selenium is an important trace mineral. And it may be that clioquinol is chelating some of the selenium. And I think many people in the audience are supplementing with selenium anyway.
Controls took those things too, or not?
I don't have that data.
One thing you have to look out for when you're getting B12, I found at least, perhaps, and I've heard this, that 20% of Alzheimer's is really a hidden B12 difficulty. And now, in the past few years, I've had 3 ladies in their 90s who gave me essentially the same story of having to quit playing bridge a few years ago because they couldn't remember the cards anymore. And after starting B12 and folic acid shots, within a week, they're out playing cards again.
This corresponds very well with the Japanese SMON, which is a neuropathy. Its symptoms are very similar to Alzheimer's,
And one of the things I want to say about administering a B12, I realized about 15 years ago that I was giving about 1,000 patients B12 folic acid B100 shots. And so I decided to get scientific about it and drew serum B12s and folic acids before giving the shot, but gave the shot anyway, and was astounded to find that the ones who had high serum B12s and folic acid did the best of all. Now,
after the shot, you mean the shot improved them the most?
Yes, and the thing is that in the medical literature, you only know about pernicious anemia and deficiencies of B12, but this implies that there is some difficulty in the utilization of B12 in the cells, and it backs up and goes high in the serum, and then when you give it in astronomical doses, then it passively diffuses into the cell and works better.
Interestingly enough, finding any other publication that mentions anything about their dosing regimen is difficult, but they did mention it in their patents. So reading their patents, they suggested either you take B12 every day orally, or you take a shot every month. And that some people had trouble with oral absorption, and they would be candidates for shots. So I need to ask you as a doctor, what does a shot cost these days?
Probably about $15. I tell you though, this also in the medical literature, you get this
once a month shot for pernicious anemia.
Yeah.
My observation is that there's some people that need these shots every 3 days.
For a short time.
Well, it depends. It varies from person to person. I ask them how long they keep the kick lasts. If they feel better for 3 days, we get every 3 days. If they feel better for 3 weeks, they get every 3 weeks.
Okay.
Steve? The mechanism for folic acid, I believe, is known.
Yes.
And it has to do with the polymorphism in the methyl tetrahydrofolate reductase gene, which affects 30% of the population. And this causes a folic acid trapping problem where there are like five different forms of folic acid, maybe more, and they circulate among each other. And one of those reactions involves B12 and an enzyme that's impaired. And so the folic acid accumulates before that enzyme and becomes deficient after the enzyme. So you have a trapping problem where your folic acid is stuck in one pool and not available in other pools. So that can explain, this is something that Dr. Kunyon talked about to this particular group, that he found that the people with the highest folic acid also had the highest homocysteine levels, and that they were resistant to therapy because of this underutilization problem.
And B12 broke that logjam?
Well, he didn't look at B12, I just mentioned the folic acid side of it, Bob has seen that for B12 as well, and maybe because these two are so closely involved with each other, there's some similarity in feedback mechanisms.
Another thing that screws up my comments is that whenever I talk, you sort of have to limit your discussion to the amount, to a certain number of things. But whenever I speak, realize I'm giving bowel tolerance doses of ascorbic acid to everybody.
Do you have any experience with methyl B12 orally?
No.
Because I tried cyanoform before and never noticed anything. And with this methyl B12, I saw like 15-20% improvement in physical performance in 1 week. So methyl is way beyond any other form I've seen. It may be as good as injection.
Did you try the hydroxy?
Second?
Did you try the hydroxy?
That's the first one. I don't know about that one. But the price of methyl B12 is 7 cents a dose.
When you look around, as I did a couple years ago, there are lots of articles, even editorials in major mainstream medical journals saying, hey guys, we know now that if you give oral methyl B12, you don't need the shots anymore. You just don't need it anymore. And you can look and you can find these. I can send you their references.
Can I move on or just?
Yeah. No, wait.
Is there any toxicity to worry about if you take large amounts of B12?
No.
As toxic as water, is it?
Well, there is if the B12 is not pure. B12 and B6 both have anti-metabolites that are produced in bacterial fermentations. But if they've purified it adequately, there's no risk.
Okay, great. Interesting.
So in my very quick search last week for B12, I walked into Trader Joe's and found out that they have 1,000 milligram sublingual for...
That's the cyano.
Cyano.
Cyano. Cyano. Yeah. It's not methyl. Forget it.
Now, I know there's this religious war about cyano versus methyl, but
it's not a religious war. It's like 2% of it gets converted into a useful form in the body.
Well, my biochemistry books say that it's interconvertible almost instantly, so I don't know the answer to that. But
it also depends on how much methionine you have or can't make from cysteine. And
okay.
There's a big story here, but I don't think it.
Methyl is a form that just occurs in the brain.
Anyway.
Cyano is an artifact of the first form that they figured out how to manufacture cheaply. It doesn't make, it's not a naturally occurring compound.
The book I read said artifact. It gets converted instantly, so I don't know.
By the way, whatever it's worth, Richard Cunin believes in the hydroxy.
And we find that iron levels increase with age as well. Theoquinol crosses the blood-brain barrier, as I've mentioned. It chelates iron in the substantia nigra, as well as chelating copper and zinc in the Alzheimer's deposits. Yeah.
Do you know why IV glutathione would have spectacular results on some Parkinson's patients? Immediate spectacular results.
It's an antioxidant. So.
I mean, it's nothing specific.
It's a good antioxidant.
These electron pairs do most of the biochemical reactions, so there's a big giant cascade that comes from it. That's why they put the selenium in, because it's part of that.
But it's also not sustainable. Most Parkinson's patients who respond to IV glutathione stop responding after repeated treatments.
Yes, I have not heard of that. Not for this, L-dopa. Perhaps that's just true of L-dopa. I had not heard that about glutathione.
Well, L-dopa probably accelerates the disease process itself, so, but that's, yeah.
So the model of Parkinson's that Julie uses up at the Buck, she gives them this awful oxidant chemical called MPTP, and it induces Parkinson's-like symptoms in mice as well as in people. If she pre-treated them for 8 weeks, 2 months, with oral cleofinol before she gave them the MPTP, and she gave them the same dose as Ashley Bush was using for Alzheimer's, that is 30 milligrams per kilogram per day, equivalent to 2.1 grams per day per human. She found, first of all, that the iron levels in normal mice was reduced in the brain, and second of all, it reduced the coordination deficit. That is, it reduced the harm to the mice induced by this artificial stress.
And what's the MPTP?
It's a, do you remember the case of the frozen addicts? It's a drug which causes Parkinson's-like symptoms by attacking the substantia nigra.
What is the designer heroin?
It was a contaminant of designer heroin. Yeah.
It's a structural relative of the active form of niacin, NAD, and it looks like it binds to the same site on complex 1 and damages it. So I'm not surprised that clioquinol doesn't block it entirely, because there's a different site of attack. But it is related. Complex 1 deficiencies are definitely connected to Parkinson's disease.
So if you want to look up the article, you can either do Medline on Dr. Jay Anderson, or you can look in Neuron, March 27th of this spring.
I think I passed it out, John. That's when you gave me a copy of that, right? It's in the packet.
That one actually, I didn't give you that one.
Oh, you didn't? Okay.
I didn't have that one on paper. I just had it on disk.
Okay.
So this one, you can go to Stanford Library and you can copy or download from the net if you've got an access to Neuron magazine. That's page 899. So how soon is clioquinol likely to be reapproved by the FDA? The oral form is off the market due to the SMON scare. As I mentioned, there are new clinical trials which took place a couple of years ago in Australia. The original patents expired decades ago. The original patents on the composition of matter expired decades ago, but Prana Biotech got a use patent using a combination of clioquinol, vitamin B12, and selenium as a treatment for Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's disease. Unfortunately, one of Ashley Bush's former collaborators from Greece went back to Greece and started a Greek biotech company, filed for the same kind of patent, and got it issued in Europe at almost the same time. So there's a legal wrangling going on about who has the use patent for clioquinol, vitamin B12, and selenium for Parkinson's disease. As a result, I interpret the reason that Prana is not wildly moving forward with clioquinol is that they figure it would cost them a lot of money to prove that it's safe and effective, and as soon as they do, Watson Pharmaceuticals, or one of the generic manufacturers, can just bring it right out. So their stated intention on their website, in their investor update information section, says that they are working to develop analogs related to clioquinol, which, quote, work better. And I think work better means are patentable.
At least,
yeah. Which is a very real consideration that you've got to answer to your stockholders. So if you or some loved one is interested in clioquinol, it may be a while before the FDA approves it and your doctor can prescribe it. What do you do in the meantime? It's not currently approved for oral use. The stuff that you can buy as a skin ointment is 99% Vaseline, and you really don't want to eat it because it's got other antibiotics in it too. Insurance won't cover unapproved drugs, of course, so if you find a way to get it, you've got to pay for it out of pocket. Then how do you monitor your progress? Maybe you can find a sympathetic doctor somewhere who will be very discreet. You will have to be discreet to protect the doctor, but if you guys can work it out between yourselves, I think it's very good to have a doctor monitoring your progress and making sure that you don't come down with SMON, or that you really have Alzheimer's and not something else, or that you're getting better. I mean, these are all things that I think in this early experimental stage, if you're going to be an experimentalist, you should be as rigorous as you can to protect yourself. This isn't just vitamin C that you can overdose. You can really overdose on this stuff if you take too much, in my opinion, and I'm not a doctor. You need to be able to measure your dose accurately. You want to be sure you're taking vitamin B12 and selenium. Finally, from reading the patents, I found that both the Greek patent and Ashley Bush's patent both suggested dividing the daily dose into four parts. They both suggested that taking too much is counterproductive. They both suggested that it goes into the brain very rapidly and then starts to leach out with a half-life of less than 3 hours, and then that's what you want. You want a washout effect. You want to take a large dose, let it build up, let it wash out. Wait 6 hours, take another dose, let it wash in, let it wash out. After 2 weeks of this, don't take any at all for 2 more weeks. So you're only taking it 2 weeks out of the month. 2 weeks on, 2 weeks off, and you're not taking it any more frequently than every 6 hours.
Why is that now that you want to do it 3 weeks on and 2 weeks off?
That's the recommendation to avoid coming down with SMON. During that 2 weeks off, you're still taking B12 every day, unless you're getting the shots
there. But it washes out so fast and has this, you know, half-life. Why is it necessary to take off 2 weeks?
I'm just telling you what I read in the patents.
Okay, I can offer a suggestion.
That if there's some collateral damage involved, giving yourself 2 weeks to recover from that would be a good idea.
At least 2 weeks.
You really don't want to get SMON. It can cause blindness, and it can cause dementia as bad as Alzheimer's. Okay.
So, is SMON something that sneaks up on you, or is it just like, you know, you have a severe problem? I mean, can you recognize it? Progression?
Well, nobody's had it for 30 or 35 years, and back then, right, when people had it, they oftentimes wouldn't report it to their doctor right away because they didn't know they had it. So they became cases whenever they turned up with their doctors really in bad shape with blindness and stuff like that. So we really don't know how quick the onset is. But you want to, I'd say you want to be cautious. Yeah?
What's the recommendation for the B12 and the selenium?
The patents recommended 1 milligram a day. That's 1,000 micrograms a day of B12 orally, or 1 milligram shots, I think they said. Is that the usual amount for a shot?
Yeah.
1 milligram shots once a month, intramuscular. They didn't say how much selenium, but I've been taking a couple hundred micrograms a day of selenium, which I think is a pretty standard amount you find in most supplements.
Hey John, could you just review the origin of the theoquinone? What was it used for?
It was used for, it kills amoebas in the gut. It was used for traveler's diarrhea. Interesting side story is that in the late 70s, I went to India as a solar energy consultant, came down with Delhi belly, and my host, who was quite knowledgeable about pharmaceuticals, got me some of this stuff. It was made by Sandoz. It had a trade name of Intestospan Forte. And he said, you can't get this in Europe or America these days, but it really works. Try it. And it did.
Is Delhi belly the same?
So this isn't bioformin, is it?
It is bioformin.
It is bioformin. I thought. I was pretty sure that's the
one. You can buy bioform cream as a topical antibiotic. You can't buy oral in the United States. Maybe you can get it in Mexico. I don't know.
But
that's your research project to find out if you can get it. And find out if you can prescribe it. I don't think you can.
John?
Yeah.
Have you checked with PCCA or any of the other compounding sources for it?
I checked with some chemical companies and found that it is available as a pharmaceutical intermediate to pharmaceutical companies, either for research use or for compounding into a legal skin cream. So I've actually been able to buy some and check it out. Mm. And the taste isn't all that bad.
What about veterinary use?
Veterinary use? So far my cats are still pretty young. I haven't seen any reports on it. I wanted to encourage Carl Kottman to try it on his dogs in Irvine.
Common,
but he hasn't.
The source of what?
Cleoquinol.
Could you use chocolate instead of Vaseline in your skin ointment?
Well, it's fat soluble. So my first experiment was to see how well it dissolved in olive oil. And it's kind of hard to get into solution. And so I tried a second thing, which actually worked much better, and that was a natural peanut butter. Oh, where did that come from? That looks like somebody measuring out a 600 milligram dose of cleoquinol and putting it in a spoonful of peanut butter. Now, I found these plastic measuring spoons at Los Altos Pharmacy, and I have a very sensitive scale, and if you pack it's a fluffy powder, if you pack it in tightly and smooth it off flat, and measure how much that weighs, it weighs exactly 600 milligrams, which turns out to be 1/4 of the daily dose that they were using in their clinical trials. So this was quite fortuitous, and I was happy to discover that. And so you put it on top of the glob of peanut butter, and then you fold it over and like you're kneading bread or something, and it gets mixed up, and it tastes pretty bland. The stuff is light sensitive. You need to keep light away. That's why this jar is wrapped in aluminum foil. You want to keep it in a cool, dry place, tightly capped. And the cost isn't too bad. You figure that if you're taking the maximum dose recommended in the patents, that comes out to a little less than 40 grams a month. And it can be gotten for around $1 a gram plus shipping. So that's reasonable price.
The only thing you haven't mentioned, I saw Ashley's presentation at the Buck last September, and he was talking about this, and he mentioned that he sees this as a preventative measure that almost ultimately everybody can take, right?
Well, there's been a lot of discussion in the aging community about whether normal people deposit amyloid beta plaques, and the growing feeling is that Alzheimer's sufferers deposit it more quickly than normal people, but that everybody deposits it at some rate, perhaps related to their inherent level of oxidative stress. And the comment has been made more than once at some of these meetings that if we lived to be 150 years old, we'd all have Alzheimer's if something else didn't kill us first. And that maybe all of us need to be concerned about nipping it in the bud, because it takes very long to progress from these early oxidative stress events through the accumulation of amyloid beta plaques and tau tangles to noticeable symptoms of memory deficit. So somebody who's forgetting their car keys and forgetting their children's names in their 60s and 70s probably has their initial damage occurring in their early 40s. So we might all want to think about this, but I can't recommend it to you because it's not legal for me to recommend it to you.
But
yes.
This is one of many possible ways to stave off the oxidative stress damage, right? And this is a exotic chemical toxic therapy. What about all the other things that we can do that involve things like alpha-lipoic acid and vitamin C and calorie restriction and all those things that don't have these, you know, all this issue with toxicity and side effects?
I'm doing all those things.
So by focusing on this discussion with these studies, we get a picture that there's some research going on this particular substance, but there must be at least as much of this research going on with other substances too, right?
Well, amyloid beta has long been recognized as associated with advanced Alzheimer's disease, and Ashley Bush's work is interesting because he found the connection with it nucleating around copper and zinc and iron and being associated with this Fenton reaction. And also, since we know amyloid beta deposits are toxic in cell culture and in vivo, and we find that this clioquinol gives us two measurable benefits. The plaques start to dissolve and go away.
Is it the only thing that makes the plaques go away?
There's one other thing that makes the plaques go away, but it makes them go away more slowly and it causes harm. And that's the antibody treatment that was stopped in mid-clinical trial. Now, the antibody treatment dissolves the plaques, but it doesn't sequester the metals. And that's the difference between this and the antibody treatment. Nothing else that we know of makes the plaques go away.
So that's my question.
Okay.
John, according to Life Extension Magazine in their August 8th issue, and also in their big summary issue, they claim carnosine does the same thing.
What does?
Carnosine. For, here's their summary statement. For the foreseeable future, the significance of clioquinol research lies in its validation of copper zinc chelation as an effective therapeutic mechanism for Alzheimer's disease, a mechanism shared by inexpensive natural agent that is currently available, carnosine.
Did you say carnosine or carnosine?
Carnosine, C-A-R-N-O-S-I-N-E.
I think that's something we should follow up. But I don't always believe the first thing I read from somebody who's selling something.
Because I tell you what, let's adopt a new tradition. Whoever speaks, stand up, because I'm having a hard time hearing everybody.
Same here.
Okay. So if you all, when you hold up your hand and you recognize, if you please rise and then we can all hear you. Is that good?
Good idea.
Good idea. I just want to point out that in the July issue of Life Extension, they had a drug called GPC, and they had an extensive article, and when in the Sunday meeting of the club, with your permission, I'll make 20 or 30 copies of
sure.
this thing.
Absolutely.
And the point is that we got it, and Leo here is taking it, and
what is it?
We don't know.
It's BPC?
BPC? What's GPC?
GPC, right, right.
Alpha GPC, if you want to know what it's called, it's glycerophosphorylcholine. Choline is, I think, the key word here.
What's it for?
It's for general mental decline, and I'll read you part of what they
let's do this on Sunday.
Yeah,
okay.
That's an important topic, by the way. There's a lot on that now. And I think Ward Dean is
Ward Dean is recommending it, and a lot of people are recommending it. It's really big, and Life Extension is selling it in their Cognitex formula. Mm-hmm. So I think what it does is it regenerates, it helps the neurons regenerate. So that's very nice. If you could do that Sunday, it'd be nice.
So for those who arrived late, Phil is having a salon at his house Sunday afternoon at 3 till 5, followed by a potluck dinner, and we'll have a furtheration of this discussion so that we don't end up staying here till midnight tonight. Are you still publishing your newsletter, by the way?
We're not. We're on trying to get it like that.
Okay. It was a good one while it lasted.
Thanks.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Have you done a reference PET scan? Do you intend to?
I don't have the ability to do that research.
Go to your doctor and ask for one? I mean, how will you know you're making progress?
I think
progress?
It's a great idea to do it, and I would encourage anybody that can do it to do it, provided they're not too worried about injecting radioactive nucleides in their bloodstream.
There's always a problem.
Details.
You know, when they say that in the clinical trial in Australia, the phase 2 clinical trial, it delayed the progression of Alzheimer's by 9 months, I'm not exactly sure what that means. I mean, does that mean that it delayed the onset of death due to Alzheimer's by 9 months, or what does it mean?
Well, that's all that Julie wrote in her article that mentioned this meeting in Stockholm a year ago, mm-hmm. was what I just told you.
Yeah.
I assume that it didn't mean that they waited until they died, because I don't think that many died in 2 years.
So
I think they were doing cognitive testing and
right.
memory testing, mm-hmm. and that they were able to rank the placebo group against the group that was getting the actual drug, because this was a properly done double-blinded placebo-controlled experiment, and they didn't they did all the assessments before they found out who was getting the real drug.
Yeah, I'd like to just make one suggestion, if I could. If the clopidogrel chelates the metals and causes the amyloid plaque to dissolve, then that would protect the neurons that were there, but they would probably be in a damaged and weakened state, and it would probably take them a while to get healthy again. So it seems to me that you might have to look further down the road for some of the benefits of this. So I think there's a lot we don't know about this yet.
There's certainly a lot more research that we could benefit by seeing done, and we should encourage our NIH and NIA to get into this.
Right. More questions?
Before we leave the subject, I wanted to say, I guess most of you know this, but maybe some of the young ladies don't know this. Never take aspartame in your body in any shape or form, because some people, it will trigger off Alzheimer's. That's methyl alcohol. If you want to drink some small amount of radiator fluid, then have yourself a NutraSweet drink.
Yeah, diet Coke is particularly damaging.
That's a very good point. Very good point. I agree with that.
It's
pushed so hard.
Are you familiar with, there was an article in Science, I think May, on homocysteine and Alzheimer's, and they showed that serum levels of homocysteine were related to Alzheimer's.
I heard the headline, but I didn't read the article in detail. What did you get out of it?
It was very interesting. Because I forget exactly, I have to go back, but it looked like a well-done study, and there were about 1,000 people in it. And they looked at serum homocysteine levels, and they treated them with V6, which makes sense biochemically. And I think there was some significant reduction of symptoms. So
that's good.
Yeah.
I think it's probably salubrious for all of us to be taking all of the various antioxidant vitamins and minerals that they may all work synergistically together.
My doctor puts all his patients, and he has a lot of aged patients, he puts them all on B12, folic acid, and B6. And he says that they get no age-related memory decline and no artery events, heart attacks at all, just from those three things.
In how many years?
He's been doing this for 20 years.
And he's saying that even at age 80, 90,
that if they come to him with age-related memory decline, it stops. That's what he says. And he also says he stopped measuring homocysteine because it always just goes...
And what dosage was that, do you know?
What the normal literature doses is saying, I think.
Excellent.
Who is your doctor?
My doctor I use is in Tucson. His name is John Donovan, MD. I'd also like to point out that he was here at the last talk.
Mentioned that the people that carry the folic acid gene mutation, their homocysteine doesn't come down in response to folic acid and B6 and B12, that it stays high. It's very resistant to coming down.
Right.
And so it'd be a good idea that if anybody's concerned about these kinds of conditions to get their genetic status for that particular...
Is there a gene test for that now?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Is there, gene tests like that?
Well, there are a variety of them out there. I can't say I know all of the market what's out there. I had it done, and I came out negative, but this is something that I've been familiar with in the Down syndrome research that I've been doing for more than 10 years, and it appears that this particular mutation is a risk factor for Down syndrome, for miscarriages, for spina bifida, and twins.
Yeah.
So if you look back in your family and you see these kinds of traits in relatives, you know, near relatives, you might want to get yourself screened and suggest that they get themselves screened.
Was that the MTHF?
Yeah, MTHFR.
So in closing out this chapter of our discussion, I'll leave you with a quote from Ashley Bush, which he says, "Clioquinol or similar compounds may have utility in other degenerative diseases where abnormal metalloprotein biochemistry is implicated, such as Parkinson's disease, cataracts, prion diseases, and ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease."
Okay.
Yeah.
One question. A few years back, I was reading in one of the journals looking at Alzheimer's disease and the question of aluminum being present, so they decided to analyze for that. They used neutron activation analysis, which is very accurate. And they went to the nucleus basalis, which is the core set of collagen mirrors. So they inspected those. Of controls, these are post-mortem of controls and those who had Alzheimer's disease. And the aluminum content was the same. And everything else was the same. And the only thing that was different, surprisingly, was the mercury content, the cesium content, and the bromine content were all higher. Not by much, but significantly statistically.
When was the study done?
About 1978.
78. Okay, well, Ashley Bush did more recent studies and found elevated levels of copper, zinc, and iron in those particular parts of the brain that are high in amyloid beta plaques. And he's found those metals actually in the plaques. So maybe between 1978 and 1998, they made some improvements in their sensitivity.
I'll go back to the article and see if it was intracellular.
What I'm saying is, in 1978, techniques were not as sensitive as they are now. And that might be part of the reason for not finding a difference.
John?
Yeah.
Do you know if in that research that all the different minerals were assessed and only those came up, or did they just only look at those?
I don't know.
Because in idiopathic cardiomyopathy, all the minerals are high, but mercury is like hundreds of times higher than cadmium and arsenic and other things, and so there's a disturbance of metal secreting systems. And so just because something is high doesn't mean that this is necessarily the one that's the highest or the most significant. Likewise, with the the research that was done up at the University of Calgary in terms of looking at snail neurons and the production of Alzheimer's cascade, they found that aluminum did not produce the cascade, and that zinc and cadmium did not produce it as well, but that mercury did. Small doses of mercury caused the entire cascade of events: inhibition of sulfhydryl enzymes, production of tau tangles, and amyloid beta. And it was the only factor. They tried, 20 different things. It was the only factor that produced the cascade.
Well, if we set aside the theoretical and concentrate on the practical for a minute, Cleopanol does have these measurable effects, and whether it's doing it because of zinc and copper and iron, or whether it's doing it because of mercury or cadmium or something else, the fact is that they have measured these things in mice, and they have measured improvements in humans as well. So whatever the cause, it seems to be having some benefit.
And of course, the other thing is that there may be two kinds of Alzheimer's, the kind that's induced by mercury and the kind that's induced by transition metals. So, I mean, there's a lot to be learned. I mean, we already know, for example, that the kind of dementia that's very much like Alzheimer's can be induced by a B12 deficiency. So, I mean, there's, those symptoms may have various kinds of different origins. So we're going to find that out. But this is a lot of progress, and I'd like to give John a hand of appreciation.
One more thing about, since there was so much about B12 tonight, do not eat spirulina.
Why?
Spirulina.
Really, why is that?
Do not.
Why?
Because it, Steve could probably tell us why not to eat spirulina.
Right now.
Oh, okay. Spirulina and B12, you know about that?
The interaction between them?
Spirulina has a B12-like compound that gloms onto your B12 receptor sites and basically blows out your B12 metabolism.
Wow. Well, a lot of microorganisms produce forms of B12 that are not compatible with humans. They're analogs. That's why I mentioned this issue with B6 and B12, that when you're dealing with bacterial fermentation, as a production technique in the manufacturing process, you have to be careful to clean those kinds of things out.
Right. Okay, now let me just repeat one more time that we're going to have a salon. It should be a lot of fun. I've got the directions up here if you didn't get them. For those of you who came in late, there's a lot of stuff up here. If you already have a copy, don't take another one because we're a little short because there's so many, had such a nice turnout. Probably thanks to the publicity of Dave Yost, which I appreciate. So thank you all for coming, and I hope to see a lot of you on Sunday.
I have a question about the aspartame and females. Why particularly did you mention
why? It was just a cynical remark. They want to be skinny.
Oh, I see.
There are 3,400 medical journals published in the world every single month in every language in the world. Most of them are not translated, and most doctors obviously can't read 3,400 medical journals. They probably do the best job of coordinating and bringing all of this material together. And as a result, I would strongly advise everybody to join the organization. Normally they charge $75 a year. When you renew every year, they send you $100 worth of supplements. It's a nonprofit organization, and at the end of every year, they take all of the material, the monies that they have, and $200,000 will go to the University of Illinois, and $300,000 will go somewhere else, and $150,000 will go somewhere else for life extension procedures. Now, they sent me a card. I think they sent almost everybody a card and says, if you want to join, you can join for $45. They will then send you that 1,500-page book, and it's absolutely excellent in explaining much of what we're talking about. Plus, you'll receive this, that 88-page magazine every single month, and they'll continually send you things. One of the questions that this young lady back here asked is, testosterone. When everybody is born, they're born with two major hormones, as I understand it. One is testosterone in a man, which turns him from a baby into a man, and also cortisol, which is the fight or flight hormone that was designed a million years ago. Now, I'm not a doctor, I don't know anything about it, but the general idea is that as we age, the testosterone and in a woman, the progesterone drops. And what is not toxic at a ratio of 100 to 100 becomes highly toxic at a ratio of 50 to 1. Women go through menopause, go through great, great difficulty. And so the only way we can stop those two fellas that are following me with two shovels, because every time I slow down, they start digging a hole. So I take my testosterone. Women should take their natural progesterone, and which offsets the side effect of the death hormone, which is cortisol. So all of these things are explained in all this stuff, and it's a wonderful bargain. And I advise everybody who is not a member of Life Extension Foundation to subscribe to it.
Well, I'd like to add something.
Go ahead.
The Life Extension book on diseases, disease treatment, is like a telephone book. So I had this third edition telephone book, and I got the fourth edition, and I said, what am I going to do with this? So I drove over to the doctor's office, and I gave it to him. And I gave it to his nurse, and the next day he called me, and he says, this is the most fantastic gift I ever got.
That's a doctor?
This is a conventional medical doctor, and he was so excited about getting this thing. So I thought this might be a good thing if you get the new edition and have the old one, is give it to your doctor.
You'll still be ahead of, right?
Incidentally, this is a second announcement for everybody. If you can contribute your $5, if you haven't tonight, to all of the material that's been put together here and everything else, we would appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah, the $5 is really important because we flew down out from Florida, and it cost us, with buses and everything else, $330. John is an independent scientist, and that means he's not as wealthy as most scientists. I did about $120 worth of photocopying, $87 worth on that packet that we passed out, which I think is really valuable. And I hope you find it so. So please, make the donation of the $5. And we hope to, keep up our kind of ambitious program, and we may have to start charging everybody every $5 every time, which I think is still not a big problem, since the movies cost $7 or $8, and they don't extend your life. So. $9.50. So there you go. So okay, now let's see.
You mentioned something about $50,000 for payments.
Oh yeah, right. By the way, Mike Cork's friend Stephen Strom is also an advisor to Life Extension Foundation, and Stephen Strom and Mike and I have been in correspondence by email about Life Extension funding a study at Stanford through a professor that I'm in touch with there, and I won't tell you his name yet because I haven't cleared it with him, but he was gone all of July, so I have to make contact with him now and try to talk to him about it. We're going to try to do the Omega C study, and Tom and Mike talked about a week ago, and Bob Cathcart was consulting on this. We want to do it on hepatitis, an acute hepatitis with high liver enzymes. And I guess when you have acute hepatitis, high liver enzymes are the sign of it. Is that right, Bob?
We're checking with Bob Cathcart.
Yeah. Yeah. When you have acute hepatitis, are high liver enzymes a sign of that?
Yeah, one of them, sure.
Sure, okay, yeah. Because we want to be sure that, we're taking people who are fairly seriously ill with hepatitis, and it isn't just dormant, because one of those diseases that...
Which hepatitis are you talking about?
ABC.
All of them.
Yeah. Right. And the reason for that is we want to get a successful test and demonstrate that large doses of vitamin C administered by IV will do the job. And hepatitis is kind of a slam dunk, really. Acute hepatitis is a slam dunk. So no one believes that, but we're gonna demonstrate that.
Oh, great.
So anyway,
One of the fastest.
That's what's going on.
The enzymes drop abruptly.
We do give intravenous cyclophosphamide.
Yeah, you know, Bob Cathcart's the world's authority. He's done more of this than any other doctor in the, probably in the face of the earth. And hopefully he'll lose his title in a few years when we were able to get this to the general public. But for now, he's the Barry Bonds of IV administration of C. And did you hear what he said? That when you do administer this to people with acute hepatitis, their enzymes plummet immediately. That's one of the things about Mega C. But I get excited about Mega C. I'll restrain myself and not further about it. But that's what's happening. Harvey, would you like to report on the poll?
No,
I'm
sorry.
Yes, sir.
Tell me about the Tom Levy talk being on
that. Yeah, Tom Levy's talk. Tom just wrote the book about Omega C. It's now available on the web. And on our website. Our website, smartlifeforum.org. If you search for it on Google, it won't come up yet, but it will in a couple weeks. But if you put it in the address, smartlifeforum.org, and click on search, it'll pop right up. And we have a really nice website. Okay.
And that Levy's book is available as an e-copy, electronic book copy, at exlibris.com.
Right, okay. And I have copies of that book. I didn't bring any that I should have, but if any of you want to get a copy, come over. Come on. Maybe if you come to the salon, I'd like to give you a copy. I'm selling it for $20, and they're hardcover, and I think it sells for $30. So I'm just selling it at cost because Tom gave me a bunch, or didn't give me a bunch. He sold me a bunch of copies. Now, any other comments on Jim?
I want to contribute the fact that I have some articles on natural kinase. I've been learning a lot about that from the top researcher in the field, Dr. Ralph Holzberg. And I have a few of his tapes here for $10, which is a normal member fee for any one of the videos if you come here, or you can order it by mail for $15, and that's all on the website as well. So we hope to have excerpts in the future of some of these lectures. When you look at it, when I first came here and saw these lectures, I went, this cannot be lost on this. It's great that we're getting it, but I said more people have to learn about these things because it's so leading edge. And then secondly, in the current issue that Al's reading right now, the September issue of Life Extension, fabulous articles on inflammation, and it's just amazing. And they did an article on serrapeptase, and it's being found now that natural kinase is four times more powerful in its fibrinolytic activity. It's ability to eat fiber in your body. So you can type in that on Google, and you get lots of articles and the latest scientific research.
Yeah, thanks, Commissioner.
And I'd like to, one thing I was going to say, I brought two new guests, which we all like to do, bring new potential members here for the Smart Life Forum. And that's Jackie Aldana came, and she puts on seminars called the 15-Minute Miracle. And if there's enough time, she could give a minute or two to tell what she does. And then I've got here Ray Bunet. And Ray is a trained mycologist who's been studying the medicinal effects of mushrooms all through Pakistan and Turkey, working at top universities there, and looking for what they call the sacred mushroom, which is actually, they have samples of it. And this is the one that extends life and creates eternal youth, this sort of thing, and high states of consciousness. And then in addition, he's developed a phenomena that I experienced last week as far as sound healing, because I've always been interested, but don't know enough about it. He'd taken the sound of thunder, the crack of lightning, and stretched it out to 30 minutes to 45 minutes, and then did studies with hundreds of people, many of whom were severe migraine sufferers. Within 30 to 45 minutes, their migraine headaches disappeared, and more importantly, they, to this day, I guess, never returned. And if you could allow him to give a couple minutes, that's up to you. You're the moderator, so okay. That's Ray Gwinnett.
Okay.
And Jackie.
Okay. Tell you what, we'll come back to you two if we can.
Okay. All right. I've got some drops with me to talk about a topic called pulse pressure. Are there any non-professionals here who can tell me what pulse pressure is? Anybody? What's the pulse pressure? I'm sorry?
Isn't it the difference between systolic and diastolic?
Yes, it's the difference between systolic and diastolic. Does everybody know that? Because it's a rather important phenomenon that accompanies aging. And, you know, I first really became conscious of this because of my diabetic wife. And diabetes is kind of a laboratory of aging, and that's not an original statement, by the way. Yes, pulse pressure has been correlated in an article. I left an article over here for your information from the Annals of Internal Medicine of January 7th, 2003. And I'll just summarize and call attention to some of the major points. The reason pulse pressure is so important relates to what's been said before and what John Ferber is going to say, because it's a measure of the loss of elasticity in the blood vessels and left ventricle output, all of those things. The difference between, you know, we all know that the norm for systolic, the upper figure in blood pressure measurements when the heart pumps out, is 130, and everything above 130 is bad, and everything below 130 is good, supposedly. And for the diastolic, the pressure for the return of the blood to the heart, there we hear the figure 90, that's the benchmark. It turns out, by the way, that very low diastolic pressure is bad, because it indicates that the blood vessels aren't really constricting and really sending the blood back. And that's the rub that really this whole pulse pressure hangs on, because when the difference between the systolic and diastolic pressure is above 60, that's the danger point. And that's illustrated in a curve in this article, which I'll find in a minute. They took the Framingham statistics. As you probably all know, Framingham study was an ongoing longitudinal study which they gathered for thousands of people all kinds of statistics. Here it is. And they divided these people over a period of 20 years into three groups: people whose pulse pressure was below 60, who were at 60 or about, and above 60. Three tertiles, as they call them. And they correlated that with cumulative incidence of congestive heart failure. And it's really a dramatic difference. The high pulse pressure people, the percentage with congestive heart failure through the years grew and accelerated. And we're talking about a factor of like four or five times compared to the people with low pulse pressure. And it's an indication of this process of glycation, really, and stiffening of the blood vessels, which John Ferber will talk about. And there are ways of fighting it. It's a long, complex subject. Usually what's indicated in the pharmaceutical armamentarium are things like ACE inhibitors. And we could go into how they work. And then there also is another class of drugs called diuretics, which make people pee more often and more and get rid of the sodium, which is a factor in this process. I won't go into all of that. There are also, but I do want to point out in closing that everyone should have a device like this at home and use it, because we're all at risk, and we do this every day and many times a day, actually. And it's interesting to see what works. One of the things that works in the herbal domain are hawthorn berries. That's a diuretic. So is parsley. And there are probably many others. And are there any questions? Or yeah, that was a rather brief discussion.
Is there a difference between 60 over 110 and 90?
You don't mean 60 over 110.
110 over 60.
Okay.
And the same 50 difference.
You know, that's a good question. Of
140 over 90 is obviously worse for the same 50.
Yeah, absolutely.
So pulse pressure is not the only
variable. No, it's not the only. The independent values for systolic and diastolic are obviously also important, but especially systolic. to me if it's too high. Yeah. That's a good point. Thank you. Don't forget to pick up the...
Okay,
right.
My support.
Okay. And later times, it was 37, 36, and 35. This is a tremendous increase in performance. It's not training. I think I must have more hemoglobin or something. But and I can't tell you whether it's the B12 or the CoQ10.
How much B12 is
that? 1 milligram methyl. Methyl B12, not cobalamin. Or cyano. So
that's amazing.
Good clue for I believe I have low stomach acid, which probably means that I'm probably naturally low in B12. So I'm probably correcting a problem that I have that other people may not.
Have you measured your red blood cell count?
I have no chemistry on this. My hemoglobin has been normal, and I have no scan test has ever told me I should be...
Hemoglobin hasn't changed?
Right? I have no idea. I have no data.
If you get blood every 3 months, every 2 months, they'll measure it for you.
You can explain.
You get blood every 2 months and your running goes to pop.
But now, how old are you, right?
I'm 59.
It's fantastic. I mean, just running up that hill is amazing.
It's an exercise. I'm talking about maximum effort.
And so you're running uphill for 45 minutes straight, right?
Well, I'm going as fast as I can.
I can, but just that much work is amazing. I mean, really.
It's rubber legs at the top. I mean, it's, sure. Can't run any faster.
Stan.
Okay, the B12 goes to make red blood cells.
Stan, we just speak up a little bit for this.
Okay, the B12 goes to make red blood cells, which carry oxygen. So you're improving your oxygen carrying capacity.
That's what it behaves like,
and
yes.
The CoQ10 is part of the mitochondrial energy production system. And so you're producing more energy and you have enough oxygen to combine with it. And that's John's specialty.
Right. Mm-hmm. So your study is confounded. Take one or the other.
I'm not doing a study. I'm just reporting the fact. I'm not backing off on it.
Well, you know, one thing. You know, we never had a talk on CoQ10, coenzyme Q10. It's so important. Way back in 1995, I went to an A4M conference in Las Vegas, and they had a series of presentations, and one of the presenters showed a videotape of the mice. I think I might have mentioned this before. They had the two steel pans of and a steel pan was about that high, and it had the mice that were given CoQ10 and the mice that weren't. So the mice that weren't aged normally, and they were kind of gaunt and gray and walked painfully around the bottom of the tin. And the ones that got the CoQ10 were brown and fuzzy and kind of pudgy and trying to jump out of the tin. I thought, my word. This is amazing, and you know, I always wanted to get a copy of that videotape. It only lasted probably about 10 or 15 minutes. I just saw that it is available somewhere. I mean, other people thought it was memorable too, and I just saw it was available. I don't know if I made a note and threw it in my file on CoQ10 or not, but point is this. You all ought to be taking CoQ10. If you're not already doing it, that's definitely something you should research.
What dosage do you recommend?
I take 100 milligrams twice a day.
Twice a day?
It's expensive, but having seen that videotape, you know, I'm convinced. Steve.
Oh, about 20 years ago, the hike went up on CoQ10. So I looked into it and went down to buy some, like $20 for a little bottle like that. So
yeah.
I looked in the texts to find that it can be made from tyrosine.
Uh-huh.
Tyrosine. And since the best source of tyrosine is the bamboo shoots. You can get them at Pack and Save.
Really?
Hmm.
Okay.
Make your own.
And then you have a little lab there where you make the CoQ10.
How do you do it? You don't need the bamboo shoots.
Is this one in here?
Yeah.
Let's open it.
Hey, how do you do it? What do you do with these bamboo shoots?
Do any of these windows open?
Yeah, they do.
Okay, good. Thanks.
There's something else that Harrison does for you.
Yeah.
I'll tell you later.
Okay. Okay, good. Now, ordinarily what we don't usually have so many little reports, although this has been wonderful, and I appreciate, thank you all, Don, Harvey, Stan, Rob. What we usually do is we have an open forum where people can ask questions, and we just all kind of try to work as a kind of a collective mind and pool our resources and our information to try to answer people's questions. We've got a little bit of time to do that still, but I want to talk to get the two new people in.
Phil?
Yes.
I spoke to Steve about the October time.
Right.
Question. He said yes.
I wanted to say that any of you are unwise enough to take Lipitor, that Merck, many years ago, came up with the idea of Lipitor, and it
prevents the formation of cholesterol by the same pathway that we make CoQ10. Right. And their scientists knew that, and so they patented a combination of Lipitor and CoQ10. They have two patents on this, but the chief executives of Merck decided this would be poor publicity, so they hid this, so that they figured that a few thousand deaths from cardiomyopathy would not be as bad as the loss of profits on Lipitor. So now that the class action suits have started on this, so they've got this information, and of course millions of dollars are being paid off because of this, but of course it's a $1 billion industry, so that doesn't make any difference.
So you take this statin drug, right? They derive all the statins from red yeast rice. Yeah. So people think that red yeast rice is natural, so it's good. Mm-hmm. It's the same.
Okay, good point. So if any of you are taking statin drugs, you ought to be aware of this, that it inhibits the body's production of CoQ10, and so you should supplement with CoQ10, or really probably try to find an alternative statin drug.
Along that line, for a long time, the alternative people were against the statins like Lipitor and others, but now Stephen Sinatra, the top cardiologist, and a few others have come out and said there are some advantages to the statins, where one is mentioned for Alzheimer's, and another is for calcium calcification, like aortic stenosis and things like that. And Sinatra himself, in his publication, said he would take Lipitor and Mevacor if he had aortic stenosis or any of those, or the other things. So maybe Cathcart or Miller can say something on that. So
take Q10 with it?
Of course, Q10 will always be with it, but for a long time they were saying, like as Dr. Cathcart thought, if you're foolish enough to take it, has been the attitude for a long time, but now they're coming out and saying it's doing these wonderful things. Is that true? Well, what do we know about it?
You're going to see more of this. You're going to see, I think, even maybe bowel cancer. You're going to see more.
Is that up, dude?
There's more indications that you're going to see for using these statins. My question is, the important question is, how much of this is secret marketing, and how much is this really based on good research? And I don't know the answer to it. I think, you know, in some ways, it sounds to me like a market looking for more outlets. Mm-hmm. That's what it sounds like to me.
Yeah.
Because I still don't want to use statins.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But you are going to hear this more. You're going to hear it for more reasons or indications for using this. Mm-hmm. So you're going to hear a lot.
Well, you know, there's a lot of other ways to bring down your cholesterol, like niacin and improving the thyroid function.
Polycosmol.
You know, most people who have high cholesterol, if I'm not mistaken, have low thyroid function. Isn't that right? Isn't there a correlation?
No, I'm not.
Is that right?
Yeah. It's not that cholesterol is a very complex subject, and so just reducing cholesterol alone, you know, half of all people who have heart attacks have normal cholesterol.
Right.
So when you look at the whole cholesterol picture, it's so rich that you have to look at everything else, lipoprotein A and everything else. And so the problem with the statins is it's just looking at one simplified notion of getting the LDL down without looking at the whole picture. That's the problem. Mm-hmm. It's a quick fix.
Yeah, good. Okay, tell you what. Yes, Steve.
Kuhn, in his book about 25 years ago, discussed this, the cholesterol thing. Everyone, if they haven't read it, should.
Richard Kuhn?
Richard Kuhn.
Kunin, K-U-N-I-N.
I speak of Janet.
Yeah.
Right. It's called Mega Nutrition.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, most of you, I guess, know, but, you know, the whole concern about cholesterol has been, is obsolete, not, well, there's still cases where you have to worry about it, but cholesterol doesn't turn out to be the primary culprit in arterial disease, in cardiovascular disease. It just doesn't. It's a minor risk factor, and there's whole books now on the myth of cholesterol. It was one of the first things that we got onto, and it got tremendous publicity, and now everybody's aware of it, but it's very old science, and it's been superseded by a lot better science. So, you know, I would look into that. There's even a book out called The Myth of Cholesterol, I think, and I've seen several good discussions, and it's a little bit of a scandal almost that it's still around, you know, with given such priority when it really shouldn't have.
We have to fight with our conventional position, because my wife's cholesterol, low density cholesterol, that's a bad one in their opinion, is a little over 100. If it's 101, it's bad. If it's 99, it's okay. That's what they tell me. They go by the rule, the book. That's the book.
Right.
Some committee decided that somewhere. Well, her low density cholesterol is maybe 110, 115, but her HDL is around 70.
Phenomenal.
Yeah, and they want to give her a statin drug. So I have to fight them. I don't want that statin drug.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's really crazy, because they should really subtract the HDL and use that as a measure. But
the danger of cholesterol is in the oxidation of it. So when you have high cholesterol and are not taking antioxidants or enzymes, then there's a big danger of it being oxidized. Mm-hmm. And that contributes highly to arteriosclerosis. Mm-hmm. So cholesterol does correlate for most people with heart disease, but it's not the cholesterol. It's the oxidation of it. Mm-hmm. So one of the things you can do is take a great deal of antioxidants.
Like C and E.
Especially fat soluble,
yeah.
Which is E, and C generates, E generates E. Mm-hmm. And they're all connected, glutathione and CoQ10, and they're all connected to the system. So, yeah, cholesterol is dangerous if you don't know anything about nutrients, mm-hmm. which is what most of the public
right.
is. Right. And one of the things during the Korean War that they found out is that the soldiers came back with arteriosclerosis. Mm-hmm. Young 20-year-old soldiers had arteriosclerosis and died quickly. The analysis of it was oxidized cholesterol. Mm-hmm.